Alleluia, Christ is risen. With that proclamation, your proclamation, God in Christ Jesus makes a promise to the disciples then and to us now. Promises that though he will be betrayed, subjected to a rigged trial and crucified, promises that though he will be gone, God in Christ Jesus will remain with the disciples, is still with us today. God in Christ Jesus' presence is critical. He heals the sick. He reaches out to people neglected by society. He embraces those no religion has ever embraced. God in Christ Jesus' presence is critical to the well-being of the disciples, to the well-being of the communities he changed, to the well-being of our own community, our city, our nation, our world. God in Christ Jesus makes a promise, promises that though death will take him, promises that though resurrection leads to ascension and a return to God the Father, promises that though he is gone, God in Christ Jesus remains. It's an important promise, then, now, always. Not a promise to be with us in the Santa Claus kind of way, you know, sees you when you're sleeping, knows when you're awake, been bad or good, so be good for goodness sake sort of way, but with us because it is frightening for anyone to be alone. Even more frightening when you are doing all sorts of good things for other people, and people with power, people with privilege, people with their own agendas threaten to take you and your good work down. The disciples knew that threat well. And that little introduction to the story of Lydia is precisely a recounting of fear. Those cities were well known to the Romans crucifying anyone who disagreed with them. The earliest disciples knew that threat so well, they experienced the deadliness of that threat with Jesus' death on a cross and with the death of so many others at the hands of the Romans. God in Christ Jesus makes a promise. An important promise, even in the face of such a threat, even in the midst of it, God in Christ Jesus is with us, so that neither you nor I nor anyone need be afraid. Which is a bold, if not unbelievable, promise. Just look at the fear permeating our society. We've become suspicious of just about everyone. Our words and our ways with one another push us to do all sorts of things, heartless things and thoughtless things that otherwise thoughtful and heartful people defend. Fear is powerful because fear is erosive and self-perpetuating. It drives us away from one another, which is a truly distorted twist, because the very antidote to fear is engaging one another, building trust between one another. Friends, here's the thing. A century ago, a half century ago, for all its many problems, our society was shaped by people with lots of opportunity to engage one another. Everywhere from book clubs and bookstores and libraries to civic organizations like Rotary Clubs and VFWs, theater troupes, art organizations, churches, synagogues, mosques, and other religious organizations. If you want to see that sort of engagement chiseled in stone, take a look at the donor list for the building of Lincoln Center or any of our city's many museums, our public buildings, and our houses of worship. All across organizations that hold our social fabric together. Yes, some corporate and big family money, but lots and lots of individual donors too. Far more than any similar project undertaken today. I do not long for the days gone by. I can't, actually, because I was born and raised entirely on the downside of the life of these public institutions. Though I cannot and largely would not long for days gone by, my concern is the value of being together, of working together, of sustaining community together. And that, dear friends, is something we need to cultivate in our own time. Because the ways in which we interact with one another, the experiences we have with one another on Facebook and Twitter, in gym and yoga classes, are all temporary interactions. They're good for us, but they lack the value of sustained human interaction, especially with people who are different from us. Our society so very much needs. Did our grandparents and our great-grandparents disagree with their neighbors and friends? Yes, but they didn't act in the ways toward one another we act today, precisely because they participated in the building up of a society with one another. Have those who served in government always debated? Yes. But they once functioned together as legislative, executive, and judiciary bodies precisely because sustained relationships help build trust and respect for the well-being of all. What did Senator Ted Cruz say the other day? He hadn't spent more than a few minutes with the former Speaker of the House. Friends, I don't know precisely what the value of being together will look like in our day and age, what it will look like tomorrow or 20 years from now. But I do know this. We need it. We need to stop allowing fear to drive us away from one another and choose instead, make a conscious choice to come together and be together and dialogue together and commit ourselves to each other. The alternative is perilous for the human family, an increasingly fractured society, an ever more pronounced division between us and the planet we call home. My guess is, actually my conviction is, this promise of God in Christ Jesus is critical, critical to our coming together. I am with you, Jesus says, and friends, that makes all the difference in the world. With you as you engage someone you disagree with. With you as you hold someone who you struggle to love in tender embrace. With you as you risk everything for the sake of another. With you in peace, with you in confidence that overcomes fear. St. John calls that the Advocate, the Holy Spirit. Another gospel writer says, "Where two or three are gathered, there I am in the midst of you." Which makes our gathering, this assembly, every single one of you, so important. We do not simply come here. We do not simply gather here for our own good, to be nourished, to be inspired, to find respite, to be rejuvenated. Yes, those are all good things. But the most important part of our gathering, The most important part of this assembly is that brought together by God, God's promise of being with us, that promise which casts out fear, is being kept today. Look around and behold exactly what fear of being alone would want to drive out. You and me. But look around and we see one another. Jesus calls us the very body of Christ. By the gift of the power of the Holy Spirit, is still with us as the very body of Christ. And that, dear friends, has been the point of the church from the very beginning, from the minute Lydia welcomed Paul and his companions into her own home. And that is the point of the church today. None of us can fix this world around us alone. But together as the body of Christ, witnessing to when two or three are gathered, witnessing to when even enemies sit at table with one another, witnessing to the power of presence and sustained relationship, the eternal Word of God made flesh is made flesh always in us. God's promise in the beginning, God's promise to the disciples, God's promise to us and to our children's children, the promise that in spite of all else, we believe, we embody the very thing which casts out the fear of this world, casts out the very fear of being alone. And this is the critical thing. Embodied not for our own sake, but for the sake of this world of ours, which is why we shout and why we are, Alleluia, Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia.